everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are joining us from in the world. My name's Tobias McBride. I'm one of the AI ecosystem team members here hosting you guys today. I'm really excited to be hosting a fantastic talk we've got here from SensiML. They are one of our AI ecosystem partners, and I'm thrilled to have them presenting today. As I said, this is part of our AI Virtual Tech Talk series. And our AI Virtual Tech Talk series is really designed to bring together not just speakers from Arm, but also speakers from our AI ecosystem partner program who are true specialists in their field. And you're going to hear a fantastic talk today around creation for a competitive edge on edge AI and how you can accelerate that. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenters from SensiML. We've got Bruce and Chris, and who I'd like to hand over to now. Bruce.
Yeah, so hi, my name is Chris Narowski, and I'm the CTO at SensiML. And so I focus mainly on building machine learning algorithms that can run on ARM devices, such as like a Cortex-M4, M3. We have lots of experience at SensiML with making optimized machine learning run, not just for making the models run, but also experience with helping our customers collect sensor data, build machine learning models, and then finally get them running on their devices to meet their product needs.
So as I was saying, we're gonna get started. We're gonna talk about opportunities where artificial intelligence and machine learning can leverage the Internet of Things. And again, we wanna thank our sponsor, Spark Fund, for letting us give three people a chance to win $50 Spark Fund gift cards. Just answer a short poll. The link will be in the chat later. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so in the world of sensing IoT, you often want to take an action based on what is being sensed. Sometimes you have a simple if-then process, like if it's dark, then turn on the lights. But sometimes you want to take a more intelligent action based on broader activities and patterns. Perhaps you want to coach a runner on proper form. Perhaps you're helping someone recover from an injury. Perhaps you're monitoring an elderly patient or elderly relative. You might want to be looking at detecting an environmental issue, like leaves and grass are too dry and flammable, risking a forest fire, or that the ground was shaking due to seismic events rather than human activity. Perhaps you want to detect that a motor is wearing down or that a factory fan's air input is blocked. Artificial intelligence and machine learning involve the detection of patterns like these, and the intersection of AI and sensing IoT provides these opportunities, as we'll explore. Next slide, please. Now, historically, AI with IoT was implemented using cloud-based solutions, deep learning, or hand coding. The challenges with each of these implementations are numerous. First of all, most AI solutions are cloud-centric. This means your devices have to push large volumes of raw sensor data, often continuously, up to the cloud. This generates high network traffic loads. Then your device has to wait for a response from the cloud, introducing further latency. This is also not very reliable, especially in poor connectivity situations in the field or on the factory floor. If the connection is disrupted, the device may not know what to do. And as with any cloud-centric solution, there are data security and privacy concerns. Now, some models also require deep learning, which require large training data sets. So a large data capture cycle before you can even train your model. Deep learning also needs a large memory footprint and high processing workload and power use. So your device is more likely to be more expensive and have poor battery life. Finally, some models require scarce data science expertise and have a lengthy development cycle. Even for a good development team, existing AI libraries are complex to use. And worse, you don't know if the output code will even fit on your device until you've completed the development cycle. And should any changes be needed, perhaps your model doesn't perform well, perhaps you want to adapt to a slightly different use case or a sensor or microcontroller unit, you need to start much of the development cycle over. It's a very slow and very expensive process and just doesn't scale or let you be competitive. To overcome these challenges, SensiML empowers you to put AI at the edge where the IoT devices live. So SensiML accelerates creating your AI solutions on your edge devices. Now let's talk about what this means. So SensiML enables your IoT devices to run machine learning models on your devices with optimized to your hardware, sensors, and training data autonomously without relying on the cloud or any connectivity. And the locally run algorithm means rapid response without cloud-based latencies, so you get real-time responsiveness on your devices. With an expansive library of machine learning algorithms, SensiML helps you choose the best model based on your data to meet your unique needs with models as small as 16K. And you won't need to be a data scientist or spend months hand coding your algorithm to get it up and running. You can alter the machine learning model code as desired to meet your needs. All right, now next, I'm going to talk about how it works on the device. So SensiML enables, I'm a little behind here. So with your ultra low power microcontroller on your device, the raw sensor data comes from one or many types of time series sensors, one or many sensor streams, and then is processed by the SensiML AI models you built, determines the only applicable events based on the parameters you specify to determine triggering events that are of value to your solution. And if desired, you can push your event data instead of raw sensor data to other systems, including the cloud. Again, all this happens within your IoT device. And the SensiML Knowledge Pack is optimized to take advantage of the capabilities of the Arm Simsys DSP and neural net libraries. Now, the market for this is huge. With most people in the world are aware of video sensing going on in the top right in the pink and red circles. Activities such as video object classification and recognition use a lot of power and require significant processor capabilities. Now, SensiML is focused on the use cases in the teal and blue circles, from industrial IoT and process control to health monitoring, motion, and audio sensing on lower power devices. For as you can see in the bar graph on the right, the market, the opportunities for you to sell these low power devices will be huge. Now, there are many market applications for these devices. Now we're talking about determining a machine might be starting to wear down, malfunction, or being interfered with, or an issue on the factory floor or assembly line, wearables to help the worker on the factory floor or the consumer at home, automating the smart home, building smarter cities by monitoring road events such as ice, traffic, or accidents, reducing energy expenses in cities and in smart buildings with activity and presence detection, helping the elderly live at home longer, helping the injured recover more quickly, or helping athletes with peak performance. Even public health measures such as checking on human health with COVID detection or the health and quality of animals and plants on the farm. The applications are endless and the market opportunity is for you as well. Next slide, please. All right, so we've talked at length about what edge AI will enable you to do, but let's talk about how SensiML accelerates you creating your edge AI solutions. So SensiML offers production quality tools for your real world products. SensiML provides a complete pipeline, a complete end-to-end AI workflow, not just an annotation tool or a modeling framework, a full production pipeline. The SensiML Analytics Toolkit addresses the leading cause of AI project failure by helping you ensure high quality data labeling. It also creates your optimized machine learning algorithm and helps you test and validate the solution on your device. SensiML provides full source code to your models for both transparency and flexibility, so you can optimize for your environment. And the SensiML Toolkit was built from the ground up to support commercial development teams with multiple workflows and revision control. And SensiML has the widest range of hardware platform support, distributions, partners, along with our global support team. Now we're going to talk about that complete end-to-end AI workflow. So the SensiML workflow is optimized towards data-driven rapid model creation. First, you use the SensiML Data Capture Lab to load your time series sensor data and label significant events. Here, the only expertise you need is around your data. If you're developing a tool to improve boxer performance, as you can see in the little picture, you need to know a jab from an uppercut and a good jab from a bad one, good form from bad form, but nothing about data science or machine learning. Then once you've labeled your data, you use the SensiML Analytics Studio to build your desired optimal model. This can be as simple as clicking next, or as custom as you need. Again, this does not require data science knowledge for AutoML, or you can tune the model or even fully control the pipeline in Python. Then you can test on your device with the SensiML test app with a binary or library built from the model, or even the model's C source code that SensiML provides, so you can embed it in your own code. But again, no data science or AI expertise is needed. And you can even test a binary without coding. In fact, for our popular fan demo, which you can see on our website, we went through this entire cycle of data capture, labeling, building the model, and testing it on the device within just one day. Now we're going to dive a bit more into each of these tools. The SensiML Data Capture Lab helps you label your training data. It supports large data sets and multiple users collaborating on multiple projects. In the example shown, you can see time series data from three accelerometers matching up against the synchronized annotated video of a test subject punching. With this sleek yet powerful user interface optimized towards labeling productivity, you can quickly annotate key events and efficiently train your model. Once your training data has been labeled, you then load it into the SensiML Analytics Studio. Here in the SensiML Analytics Studio, you can build your model automatically with AutoML or with directed model creation. You can choose among dozens of different optimizations, rapidly repeat the process with different choices without any time-consuming coding cycles, and see visualizations around how various tuning performance parameters affect your performance. All of this within a streamlined user interface experience. And once you have built your desired model, you can then test it. So SensiML includes a test app for both Windows and Android that allows you to validate your model on your target device. The test app supports real-time and logged event data creation, rich visualizations, and debug information. And as you can see in the Android example, you can monitor the model in action with live events as your IoT sensor runs, such as this example of a washing machine overloaded. And of course, your model will be highly optimized for Arm SimSys. Now the resulting model, your SensiML knowledge pack, runs on your device as optimized by your team. All right, so let's review how the model runs. Now that you have your IoT endpoint model, the SensiML knowledge pack on your device, you have a real-time runtime on-device sensor processing. Again, your raw sensor data can be from varying types of sensors, one or many time series sensors, one or many channels of sensor data, up to 1 megahertz sampling rate. Your created SensiML model pre-processes the data to optimize for event detection. The machine learning model then adapts the signal as appropriate, transforms the features, and classifies as appropriate for your application. This results in the desired event detections to trigger the desired reactions, all instantly on the device and without any cloud connectivity or latency. All right, so next I'm going to turn it over to our CTO, Chris Narowski, to demonstrate this in action. Take it away, Chris.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, Bruce. So let me go ahead and share my screen. Stop my video for this. So what I'm gonna walk through today is the SensiML Data Capture Lab, the Analytics Studio, and then finally flashing a knowledge pack to an ARM device and showing the classifications in real time. So for this, we're gonna be using a fan demo. And so we're gonna do the fan demo. So we have a simple fan and it's attached to, we have a microcontroller attached to it that has an accelerometer on it. So I'm gonna start by opening up the Data Capture Lab, which is where we have our project. And so when the Data Capture Lab opens, we can see here on the left is the Project Explorer. And so I'm gonna pick one of the files for the data that we've collected. So if I open this file here, which is one that I previously collected, you can see here that we have a number of graphs. And on the right here is the video of our fan. So here's the fan, and here's the microcontroller attached to it up here. And it has the accelerometer on it. And so in the chart here, you can see the accelerometer X, Y, and Z right here. And then on these three charts down here, we just have the accelerometer X, Y, and Z broken up. And what we've done is we've gone through and labeled this data set using the video right here. So as we play the video, the time moves here and the time moves here, and this helps us identify what's going on in our time series data. Unlike if you just have, if you're labeling video data or if you're labeling audio data, when you have time series data, if your data collection methodology isn't really great, or if you don't have a video to help you sync up, it's really difficult to understand what's going on in that data without that additional context. So we use the video to help us label these events. To label an event, all we need to do is right click on the graph, and we can move these markers around, which identify a start and end of the event. And then once we have put the marker down, we can just label what that event is. And that's going to help us to build out a corpus of data for whatever we're trying to predict or classify. So let me switch over to data capture mode real fast. And I'm going to connect to our sensor. And then I'm also going to connect to our video. And let's get a camera preview real fast. So you can see here is the video stream for the video that we're recording. And so I'm just gonna very quickly, so I can come down here and I'm gonna say unknown, or we'll just record some of the fan on. I'll bring this over here so you can see what I'm doing with the fan. And then I'm going to go ahead and plug the fan in. And so you can see the sensor signal right here is changing. And then I'm just going to click begin record. And when I click record, it's going to start storing the video, and it's also going to start storing the sensor data. And then when I hit stop recording, the sensor data and the video are saved, and the sensor data is uploaded to the cloud. So let's switch over and look. So here's the sensor data that we just recorded. And we can see that the video is right here and it's synced up with the sensor data. And so if I right click and drag, I can label all of this as fan on. And then I can click save, and that'll add us. When I click save right here, that's going to add the label to the graph. And now when we go to build our machine learning models, we'll be able to create a query that's going to include this sensor data. So that's the quick demo of the Data Capture Lab. It has a lot of more advanced functionality, but it's a really performant data labeling tool that you can use offline and online, and use it to collaborate with other people in your team. You can use it to version your data labeling and build up a really large, really high quality data set, which is really important for building your machine learning models. So once you have labeled your data, the next thing we're going to do is jump over to the Analytics Studio. And so you can get an account for the Analytics Studio for free if you go to sensiML.com. And you click the Get for Free button. You can sign up for our Community Edition, which is great for people that are just starting out and want to build a POC. It has some limitations, but none that are going to get in your way of building out a proof of concept for your model. And then once you're happy with that, you can subscribe to our platform and get access to the full source code, multi-user accounts, and all sorts of additional enhancements that help you go to production. So I'm already logged into the SensiML Analytics Studio. And so what I'm going to do here is open up the project that we just created. So let me click refresh. So here's the Arm fan demo. So we're going to open up that project. And so you can add a project description or image for your project. And you can also see the complete overview of how many captured files we have, how many queries, how many pipelines we've run, and the number of models that we've created so far. And so here's a quick overview. So for each capture that I've collected so far, it has a unique name, it has a unique UUID, and then it has a number of different events that have been labeled on it. It also has additional metadata that we've captured. So which device was used to collect this data, how the data was collected, and then where was the device mounted? And then I also added another metadata, which is the set. So do I want this to be part of my training set or my testing set? And so what we can do with that metadata is we can go and build a query. So here's a query we've already created. And when we go and look at it, so I've created this query. So it's, and I named it Q1. It's using the session, which is the labels that we've put down. And it's using label. And then we can query out different metadata to help us build a more accurate model. So if I wanted to come in here and click set, and then I can create a segment filter on that set to say only pull in my train data. And then I can say save. And what that's going to do is it's going to modify the query, and it's only going to pull in the data that meets these criteria. On the right side, I can see an overview of how many segments of data we have for each type of class. So we have four different classes. One is blade obstruction, one is blocked flow, one is fan off, and one is fan on. And we also can switch and look at a samples view. So while I may have only labeled a couple of segments, it actually, each segment has a large amount of data in it. So we actually have 40,000 samples, time samples of blade obstruction, 80,000 of blocked flow. And so we can use this to get an idea of if we're going to have a balanced data set or if we've collected enough data for each class. So for this model, we were collecting data at 333 hertz for accelerometer X, Y, and Z. And so now I'm going to switch to the build model screen. And so in the build model screen, what we can do is we can specify our query that we want. And this is so our automated machine learning approach. We can specify the query that we want. We can specify the window size. So how many samples of data do we want to feed into our model? And then we can specify the optimization metrics, such as F1 score, and then also the total classifier size. So you may know for your particular application how much available RAM and flash that you have that you can allocate to your machine learning model. And so this is going to allow you to only pull in generate models that fit within that constraint. We also have a number of advanced settings that help you more direct the AutoML process to better suit your specific application. And so for this one, I'm going to remove the mean from the data set. And essentially what that's going to do is remove gravity out. We're going to filter outliers and do some feature selection using thresholding. And then you can select from a number of different feature families. So I've only selected frequency here, and that's going to pull in about 10 or 12 different feature extractors that are based on frequency features. I could also select any number of these, and each of those consists of 10 or 20 different types of feature extractors that fall within that category. And then you can specify your validation settings, as well as the parameters for searching using the AutoML process. And then the next step is to click the Optimize button. And so I'll just go ahead and do that now. So for this model, the window size is set to 400. And so what that means is since our sample rate is 333 samples per second, we're going to get a classification. We would expect to see a classification about every 1.3 seconds. And so when we click the Optimize button, what it's going to do is it's going to run through a number of different machine learning models and optimize each of those. It's also going to extract all of the different features that we have, run a number of different feature selection algorithms, and do some hyperparameter tuning across all of that using the validation metrics that you've chosen. And then it's going to return to us the top five models that it finds, ranked based on the optimization metric, as well as the classifier size and the number of features that it uses. So this is just going to run for just a little bit. So I didn't set the optimization time very long. We delete advanced settings. So here I just set a small initial population and only a couple of iterations. So I expect it to come back really fast. So we'll just give it a second. So what it's done here is it's run through a couple of iterations of the genetic algorithm. And it's now, once it's finished and it's done the hyperparameter tuning, it actually just runs on all of your training data to build the best model that it can. And so that's what it's returning here. So we can see this first model came back and it said, based on our training data, it has 100% accuracy. We can look at it in a bit more detail to see which features it selected. So it selected 8 different features. And you can see those features right here in this dropdown. And you can compare them against each other to see how they actually perform based on your labels. So right here are the features that have been extracted from each of those time series sample points. And you can see, so here's where fan is off, here's where the blade is obstructed, and the brown is fan on, and the blue is the flow blocked. So with this feature, you can see like there's good separation for blade obstruction, good separation for fan off, but not such great separation here between these two classes. So probably what it's done is actually found another feature, another couple of features which give good separation between flow blocked and fan off. So right here, if we look at this feature, so fan on is, this is down here, and blocked flow is up here. So we have a good separation between these two types of classes. And so that's kind of the power of our approach is, it's not just relying on a classification model and raw sensor data. It's going to pass it through a couple of filters, extract a couple hundred features, and then finally feed those that feature vector that it generates to the classification model, which is going to give you a much more accurate model with less training data. You can come in and look at the confusion matrix, the feature summary, as well as the model summary. So the feature summary will tell you every single feature that was used, the parameters for those features, as well as which sensors were used, were fed into that feature extractor. The model summary gives you an overview of what model was used, how did we optimize that model. And then finally, the knowledge pack summary tells you what is actually going to end up going on the device as a pipeline steps. So once you're happy with, you've looked at your model and you're happy with that, we can come over here and we can click on test. So this is only going to pull in the test set, select all, and click compute accuracy. And what this does is it lets you test your model on unseen data before ever having to put it onto the device. And so you can get a good feel for how your model is going to perform without ever needing to download it and put it on the device. So it just makes one more check in your machine learning pipeline process before you go and put that model out, just to help you get a good feel for it. And also understand where the model is going to not perform well and where it is performing well. So if we click on one of these that comes back, we can see the confusion matrix, as well as the classification that was predicted. So this predicted fan on, as well as the labeled region. So we labeled this entire region fan on and predicted fan on for the entire region. So once you are happy with the tested model, the next step to do is to come in and download the model. So you can come in here and select the hardware platform. So the hardware platform that I'm using right now is called the Quick Feather. And you can select which version of the SDK do you want to build for. I can select float options, compiler options, which compiler I want to use. And then I can select from either binary, library, or source code. And so for right now, we'll just select binary, and that'll build a binary that you can immediately flash using the sensor configuration that we have. So the data source right now, this is telling me it's using the motion at sample rate 333 and accelerometer. And then we have different applications. So if you wanted to use the MQTT application, once you flash the device, you can communicate with it and get results using MQTT protocol. Or we also have a simple stream protocol, which once you flash the device, it just immediately starts sending out that sensor data. And then the next step is you just click download, and it will, our server will compile the knowledge pack to your target platform, optimized for that device type, download it to you, and you'll be able to directly flash it. So while that's downloading, I'll just point out, so once you sign up for our account on SensiML.com, you can get all of these tools that I'm showing you right now. By going to SensiML.com/download. And so the Data Capture Lab is a Windows, and there's a Windows and Android version. So you can download that. And then the Gateway app, which I'm going to show now. So I need to flash the device really quickly with the model that we generated. So right now, I'm just going to go ahead and flash the device with a model that I generated right before this talk. And I'm going to use the SensiML Open Gateway to connect to that device to see the classifications in real time. So. Okay, so we've connected to the device using this over the serial port. You can connect to it if you have BLE, you can connect to it if you have a Wi-Fi module or TCP/IP. And we switched to test mode, and right now it's just telling me the fan's off. So let me see if I can bring my camera up real fast. You remove the background. Okay. So now you can see, you should be able to see the fan in the window on the side now. And so the fan is currently off. If I plug it in, it's going to detect. It's going to switch to detect fan on. So the knowledge pack just finished downloading. And then if we block the flow by just putting a piece of paper behind it, it's going to detect flow blocked. And then the last one we have is just a blade obstruction, where we just have an impingement that goes in between the blade. And now it's back to fan on. Okay, so that was a really quick walkthrough of the SensiML Analytics Studio, and starting from collecting data and moving to creating a query to pull out only the data we're interested in, building that model using AutoML, finally downloading that model and flashing it to the device. And so I only showed the AutoML process here, but we actually have a Python client approach, which allows you to fully build out your training pipeline, specify all of the parameters for the feature extractors, and train it in the SensiML cloud. And so you have full control over everything when you're using that approach. So that is the end of my demo. Again, if you want to sign up for an account, just go to SensiML.com, click the get for free, and you can get a free community edition, and you can try out all of our tools. We have a lot of documentation. If you go to SensiML.com/documentation, you can see here all of the different firmware that we already support, or we can build libraries for generic devices. So you can see more application examples here. to get up and running yourself. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Bruce. Thanks for your time.
All right, thank you, Chris. Just give me a second here. All right, so thanks, Chris, for that very informative demo. Now, the demonstration could have been performed on a wide variety of hardware configurations, as Chris showed. And to help you with your solution, we want to point out a large number of platforms and an ever-growing list of ecosystem partners, including Arm. And of course, we are happy to help you directly. Now, remember that our model output C source code can be compiled to just about any platform in existence. And now that you're thinking about how you can use Edge AI and IoT, we're going to look at a few common use cases we've seen. Now, predictive maintenance is where you want to know ahead of time that there's a problem with your equipment before it becomes a bigger problem. For example, a mining pump has a defect, as shown in the picture on the right. If the issue's caught early, it can be repaired quickly. But if not, it could break and cost a lot more to repair, have extended downtime, and delay the entire operation. Or, as Chris was showing you our fan demo, a factory might have a machine where, if the cooling fan malfunctions, the machine could overheat and burn out. Imagine the frustration when an entire assembly line is closed, all because the air going into the cooling fan was blocked, as Chris showed. Now, with SensiML, you can train your IoT sensors to monitor industrial equipment such as fans, pumps, rails, conveyors, 24/7, and autonomously react to key events such as vibrations, noise, or damage. Another popular example is virtual coaching wearables. They're very popular consumer and healthcare technology. Everyone's familiar with the devices that count steps, but there are advanced, sophisticated applications such as determining that a person is walking properly, gait analysis, or that an athlete's form is ideal. And a new scenario we've seen recently is a team is trying to detect that an athlete's form has changed, possibly indicating a minor injury before the athlete even realizes it. Or a common use case is to help aging in place, monitoring the elderly in their home to see if their walk is less steady or worse if someone falls. With SensiML, you can train your IoT sensor to monitor human form and movement to optimize human performance, rehabilitate injury, or just live safely with 24/7 autonomous monitoring and reaction to key events. All right, so another, am I not sharing my screen? I'm sorry, I thought I was sharing mine. But not, that's why we're a little off sync here. So, all right, so for our final example, let's look at smart cities. Whether it's lighting that activates only when needed for vehicles or pedestrians, or road conditions monitoring for snow, ice, road hazards, accidents, or traffic, cities can use Edge AI to detect conditions and advise citizens or respond to events. Your IoT device can use a variety of sensors together, including vibration, sound, pressure, light sensors, and with SensiML, smart cities can operate more efficiently and to the benefit of all. All right, so we're going to wrap up here. First of all, again, apologies for my technical difficulties earlier. I thank Comcast for that. But today we thank Arm for the chance to share with you today. And again, thank you to our sponsor, Spark Fund. A reminder that we're choosing three people to win $50 Spark Fund gift cards. Just answer a short poll. The link is in the chat and on your screen. And the magic word for the poll is in the chat. And we especially thank you for joining us today to learn how SensiML can accelerate your Edge AI creation and your IoT journey. And please do not hesitate to contact me at brucepleat@sensiML.com or connect to me on LinkedIn. I'd love to hear about your use cases in IoT and in machine learning. And as the SensiML Customer Success Manager, I'm here to help your Edge AI and IoT projects succeed. I look forward to hearing from you, and thank you again for your time today.
Thank you, Bruce, and thank you as well, Chris, for a fantastic presentation and great demo. I mean, what a fantastic opportunity for you guys to learn and see this. I think it was great. We've had loads of questions come in, so I'm just going to dive straight into those. Some of them are quite quick. I think others might require more detailed answer. For that demo, Chris, what microcontroller were you using again? We just had a question come in from Gur around that.
Okay, yeah. So the microcontroller I was using was a QuickLogic QuickFeather board. It's I think the specs on it are it has 512 megabytes of SRAM Cortex-M4 CPU and an embedded FPGA. And it has an accelerometer with a 3-axis accelerometer on it. So for the demo, I was just using the accelerometer at 333 hertz. But if you go on our website, we support a number of different boards. If you already have an SDK to start with that, or if you have your own any Cortex-M-based or Cortex microcontroller, we can compile. We'll compile a library for that, and you can include it in your application.
Yes, so someone asked specifically also about a Raspberry Pi. So I guess that is a
yeah, yeah. So we also support Raspberry Pi. Awesome. Filing for Raspberry Pi.
Brilliant. Thank you, Chris. Let's jump across a few things. And again, do check out the chat for the magic word and the giveaway that SensiML are doing. I think you guys have a great opportunity to do that. Then that $50 gift card. A couple of questions around operating systems. Can SensiML run on Linux? And I think someone else has asked, any plans for Linux or a Mac version for the data capture lab?
So right now the data capture lab is a Windows 10 application. And at this moment, there's no plans to port that to Mac or Linux. You can run it inside a VM on Mac and Linux without any issues. We also have what we call the SensiML Open Gateway, which is a gateway that a lot of times I'll run on like a Raspberry Pi to collect data, and you can collect data over a serial port, over the TCP/IP connection. If you have like a Wi-Fi board attached to your sensor, and it can also do BLE. So for strictly data capture, a lot of times I'll use that and then just connect the data capture lab to that gateway to get the sensor data. So that's one option that we a lot of times recommend for people.
Brilliant. Thanks, Chris. And we've had a couple more questions around that. And actually someone came with the love the comment that from David, actually didn't know the data capture lab can sync video. That's fantastic. We agree. Yeah. I agree. I think it's great. And someone's asked about the actual process. Is there a top limit to the raw input data? And then as a follow-up, how does SensiML apply any quantization methods to save on size? So kind of two-part question there, raw input data and then any quantization methods to save on size.
Okay, yeah. So the raw input data is, we don't have specify a limit for that. We've done projects up to 100 kilohertz without seeing any issues. That's more so going to be limited by, you know, how much do you need like real time for all of the data that you're capturing, what space, how fast your processor is, can it process that, how complex the model is. So that's more around kind of like the limitations there. So it's just understanding the problem better to give like a good answer on that. But we don't actually put any limitations on that way. What was the rest of the question? So for each of the models that we generate, they're all optimized for embedded devices. So they're all quantized. Basically, all of the features that we send into the model are 1 byte, get put down to 1 byte. And so we have a number of different kind of classical machine learning models, as well as the neural networks that we use. And they're all quantized.
Thanks again, Chris. That's great. Couple of just a very quick follow-up question on the Raspberry Pi. I believe someone's just quickly asked Naveen, which Raspberry Pi to support the gateway they've asked? I don't know if you
can. It's the application is a Python application. And so I've been running it on the Raspberry Pi 3 Plus. So at least that one works without any problems. And then I've also run it on the Raspberry Pi 4. So either of those will work.
Brilliant. Thanks for that. That's great. Let's dive in a bit more into a couple of other questions here. And again, thanks for submitting all of them. We've still got about 5 minutes left, so there's a chance for a few more. I've got about 3 more to get through, but please do submit them. I think we'll have to answer a couple more on top. Leandro has asked, is it possible to see the network model itself and do the tools support complex neural networks?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so right now, for neural networks, we're using TensorFlow Lite Micro as our inference engine. And so if you're familiar with TensorFlow Lite Micro, they have a number of ops that they support. And so we support those ops, and they're working to expand the number of operations that are supported there. So as that happens, we're including that as part of our toolkit. So that's for right now. If you can use TensorFlow Lite, any operations that TensorFlow Lite Micro supports. If you want to build a neural network within the tool, you can actually, we have a couple of tutorials for doing that as part of our platform. But a lot of times the way we do it is basically you run your pipeline up to the point you've extracted your features. And then you take those features, feed them in, and you can just train, you can do this in a CoLab notebook using the Python client, where you can basically run a SensiML pipeline using Python up to the point you have features, take those features, train your neural network model however you'd like, and then upload that model back to our cloud and compile it as a single pipeline. So you can train the model yourself as long as you're using the ops that are supported by TensorFlow Lite Micro.
Brilliant. Thanks, Chris. Let's jump into a couple more. Does SensiML support feature fusion with different sources of inputs, let's say vibration, audio, images, et cetera? And if yes, how? Mm-hmm. That comes in from Marconi.
Yeah, so one of the things about our models currently is, I guess you would say it's a limitation for our models currently, is they expect all of the inputs to be at the same sample rate. So as long as you have the same sample rate, you can generate, you can fuse sensors. So a lot of the feature extractors we have do perform sensor fusion, which is looking across the number of sensors. Another option that you have, which we do a lot as well, is actually building two models. So an audio model and a vibration model, for example, is one thing that we'll do. You can run them simultaneously as their own separate knowledge pack. So basically, when you build a knowledge pack, you can combine as many models as you want, and you can build them hierarchically. So you could have, a model running that's looking for a specific vibration and a model running that's looking at audio. And when one detects something, you can have the other trigger to run. So we do support like this really complex building of knowledge packs that run on embedded devices, which is really kind of a really fantastic way to build more complex applications. So that's kind of how we support combining things like audio and vibration. It's just building a hierarchical model that takes sensor input from both.
Brilliant. Thanks, Chris. I think we're going to have time for one more question. Let's have a quick look. Any ETA for regression models from Naveen? Don't know if you can give a quick answer to that one, Chris.
So for us, regression models, we actually have linear regression as a feature. So you can have a feature extractor that does linear regression. We're looking not this quarter, but probably Q3 or Q4 to start introducing regression as kind of like a core component of one of the models you can train.
Brilliant. Thanks again, Chris. Bruce, would you mind just sharing the last slide? I think we'll wrap it up there. But again, thank you.
I can't at the moment. I'm sorry.
Oh, no worries. Look, it's no problem. I will.
Comcast is giving me grief. Yeah.
That's fine. No worries at all. No worries. The joys of the Comcast. I'm glad I'm in the UK and don't have to put up with it. So brilliant. Well, thank you guys ever so much for all your great questions. Do feel free to get in touch with SensiML, info@sensiML.com, and they'll follow up directly. There's a message just gone in the chat around that. If you guys have got any specific questions, I'm sorry, didn't have a chance to get to every single one. But I really hope you enjoyed today's talk, everyone. I mean, you can see how with very little, no data science or expertise needed for a number of areas, you can get started with these fantastic tools. And all the way from data capture to the analytics studio to testing on device, we've seen a great demo and some great material from them. And I'd really like to, on behalf of Arm, thank you guys for presenting it. And been really, really interesting talking to you guys today. Just as a very quick wrap up, please do feel free to go ahead on to Twitter, our Twitter channel, which at Arm Software Dev, and give us a tweet. Thanks very much, Chris. The slides, as I say, will go up tomorrow, as will hopefully our YouTube recording of this. So if you've missed any bits and pieces, want to recap stuff, check it out there. I pasted a link to sign up for our next AI virtual tech talk. Please do so. And in addition to SensiML's great giveaway, you know, make sure you've gone and clicked that magic word and click that link and enter that magic word. We are on our own little weekly, bi-weekly giveaway that we do. So at the end of this, fulfilling out a survey to give us some feedback on how you feel the talk went and any improvements you'd like to make. From our side, we're entering you in a chance to win an Arduino board from our side. But you know, don't make sure you check out, of course, SensiML's as well. I'm sure you did earlier on the talk as well. But yes, on behalf of myself and the Arm team and SensiML, thank you all for joining us today. We hope to see you at our tech talk in a couple of weeks' time from AITS and across our future tech talks as we carry on doing them this year. So thank you very much. And thank you on behalf of Arm and SensiML. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.